Hi. So, good afternoon. I hope everyone is still enjoying the conference, almost the last presentation. As I said, my name is Helge Hess, and I want to talk. Actually, I want to show you Swift Neo on the Raspberry Pi. I hope the hardware is going to play well with me. Not sure yet. So, this is the Raspberry Pi. I don't know, probably some people have seen it already. So, usually you always see it like as a plain board, so, but you can buy nice cases for them so they look actually good, and you can pimp them with those stickers. And I'm actually going to connect this already. So what is a Raspberry Pi? It's essentially a mobile phone, a fast mobile phone with a quad-core processor, and but without the battery, without the LTE connectivity, and without the touch display, of course. And this actually describes another device really well, which you probably know as well. So it's an Apple TV, which is an iPhone without a battery, without a display, and without LTE, right? So it's pretty much a Raspberry Pi. For the cases, an important thing, so you can also do your 3D print your own ones. So I'm working on that next cube. It's like tailored for Raspberry Pi. It perfectly fits in here. It's going to be awesome when it's ready. And then there are things like those. Does someone know what it is? It's a, sorry? No, it's a CCU3. It's a base station for a home automation system called Homatic, which was popular in Europe. And someone put that open, and it's actually a Raspberry Pi in a fancy, in a fancy case. So they sell that for 150 euros, and the Raspberry Pi is sold for 35 euros to the consumer, so they get that even cheaper. And my point is, if you manage to add value to the Raspberry Pi, you can actually sell it at a much higher price. And the best way to put value on a Raspberry Pi is by adding software to it, right? And what's the best way to do that? Using Swift, of course. And I want to notice one feature of Swift, which other environments like Node.js or Python or even Java do not have, and that is that Swift compiles to binary. And I'm not talking about the performance here, but I'm talking about the fact that you can ship that to your customers and you don't have to ship your source code. So essentially, you're protecting your IP. Because if you're shipping to your customers, you're also shipping to your competitors, of course. So that's a Raspberry Pi, but I also wanted to talk about Swift Neo, right? And if you're thinking about Swift Neo, you're not thinking about a Raspberry Pi, right? You're thinking about like a huge iCloud data center, which is like literally serving like hundreds of millions of devices, users, and so on. That's what it's built for. And if you look into such a data center, I actually worked at iCloud for a few years, but I don't really know how it looks inside of that. But it's probably like a big inter-server machines which may have like 120 gigabytes of memory and maybe 30 Xeon cores or something. And if you have that on your desk, you would probably say, wow, that's a huge number of resources, right? But that's not actually the case because such a single machine is at least responsible for like 10,000 connections, probably more like 100,000 today. So you only get a very tiny slot of them for a user, so if you get something like 10 megabytes, I think you're probably lucky. So Swift Neo, I think that's the reason why Swift Neo is so optimized for resource consumption and speed. Which brings us back to the Raspberry Pi. So if you're actually an iCloud server developer and you're looking at a Raspberry Pi and it has like a gigabyte of memory and a quad-core CPU, it's like huge resources, right? So because Swift Neo is so optimized for the very high end, for the very high scale, it's also perfect for the very small scale. And I don't want to get into the topic why Swift is better than other languages on the server. You probably heard enough about that at the conference already. The only thing I want to say, it's like it produces fast binaries, it uses little memory, and even due to that, it's still a reasonable language. So, no C++ or something like that, right? So a lot of people are thinking like the Raspberry Pi, so it's an embedded device or something, and that's always like hard to use and hard to do stuff on that, right? So I'm trying to give you a demo on how to write a small application for the Raspberry Pi. Let's see. I hope it works, because demoing software is hard already, but demoing software and hardware is even worse. So I'm in Xcode. Can you see that? Yeah, it should be fine, right? Yeah? Okay. So I'm going to create a new project. And no, not a game. So we are going to create a Swift Neo service. And we are going to call it cows service, of course. It's going to have cows. No demo without cows. And I already have the Swift Neo dependency, but I'm also going to use a small framework I wrote, which is called MicroExpress. It's really tiny. It's literally like three files. It's nothing like Kitura or Perfect or something like that. It's really tiny, 300 lines of code or something like that. So I'm going to put that somewhere. Also going to build it. So I'm going to build this for the local machine right now. We can take a look at the package Swift, so it's a usual thing. We have the dependencies for Neo and MicroExpress. And I can pull up this thing, and let's try to hit the service, not yet ready. Run it. Okay, there it is. Okay, so that's a very simple page. And I mean, that wasn't impressive at all, right? So it's just some Neo endpoint on my Mac. So it's nothing on the Raspberry Pi yet. So another question is, how do I get that stuff on the Raspberry Pi? And I don't want to go to the command line or anything. And the trick is that my Raspberry Pi is running a Docker engine. So it's actually very easy to execute stuff on the Raspberry Pi using Docker and Docker machine. So, and I have a small script for that, which I'm going to invoke from a new target. So I'm going, to create a new target. Come on. And I'm going to use an aggregate target. I'm not going to aggregate anything. It's just an empty target. And I call that deploy on Raspi. That's it. So stop the application. And in here, I'm going to add a build phase. It's a script build phase, so I have a very small script which is taking the project, compiling it on the Raspberry Pi over here. I hope that works in a minute. And then it's going to start a Docker container with the result of that. So I need to call that script over here. So Swift Xcode deploy on Raspi is a name. So, and now I can select the target at the top, and I just press build. So now this is going to take a moment, because now the Raspberry Pi has to fetch other dependencies, compile that, and start the Docker container. So it takes about 30 seconds, I think. But we can already hit the Pi. So it's this one. That's going to take a moment. No need for panic yet. I can actually see whether it's running. That looks good. Might work. So essentially, deploying to Raspberry Pi, but I'm getting through that later as well, is really easy. It's like deploying a Docker container on an Intel host. That's exactly the same thing. Let's see. Not yet. There we go. So this is exactly the same application I just ran on my Mac, deployed to the Raspberry Pi. So, but this is a cows service, and there's nothing about cows in there, so we need to change that. So we go to the package Swift, and yesterday someone asked about great packages, and the cows package, it's the best package. So I ported that. It's from Sindre Sørhus, who wrote that for Node.js. So I ported that to Swift, and it has like 400 cows in it. You're going to see that. It's great. So I'm going to switch to my main Swift. Oh, I didn't introduce that. So at the top, you have that express thing. That's essentially setting up the Neo server. At the bottom, you have the listen, which is like listening on the socket for incoming request. And in between, there are already some middleware endpoints. And I'm just going to add a chaos one, right? Because chaos. So we don't need to request. We just need to read the response. We don't need a next handler. And in here, we are just, oh, we need to import the chaos, because otherwise we're not going to have any beef. And we are going to call the wacker function, which is in that chaos module, and that returns a random cow. So I just save that, and I press build again. Again, it's going to take a moment, because it has to fetch all the cows, and fetching 400 cows, it's like, yeah, do that. So the Raspberry Pi is going to be busy for like 30 seconds again. If you would just change the main Swift, it will go faster the next time because he already has the chaos module. So by the way, I also have like two applications on the App Store. So there's a Code Chaos application for Xcode. So it's an Xcode extension for inserting ASCII chaos into your source code. And I also have an iOS app, which is called ASCII Chaos, all free, which allows you to do the same on iOS. So let's see whether the Raspberry Pi is ready. Yeah, it looks like that. So let's hit that endpoint. And there we go. So yeah. And it's, as I said, it's returning a random cow every time. It doesn't use a 4.2 feature yet. So. I could do that like all the time, so like for, I don't know. So the only thing I wanted to show you that there's nothing to be afraid of. It's like super easy to do that, right? I didn't even have to leave Xcode and go to the shell or anything like that. Okay, so let's go back to the presentation. So I did that. So what do you need if you want to do that at home? You essentially just buy a Raspberry Pi. As I said, it's about 35 euros, including tax in Germany. You probably already have some USB power. So the power, it's powered by micro USB. And then you need an SD card. And I guess everyone has some old 4 GB SD cards lying around. Otherwise, they also are very cheap. And that's it, what you need on the hardware side. But the next question is, how do I get Swift on this, right? And there are a few options. So first, you can build it from source. So you go to the GitHub page of Swift, you grab the compiler sources and everything and build it. And there's a web page called Build Swift on ARM, which explains how to do that. But note, so on a Raspberry Pi 3, which is actually pretty fast, so it's that quad-core thing, it takes 8 hours. On a Raspberry Pi 2, it takes 3 to 4 days. And on a Pi Zero, I don't want to talk about that. So it's better to just go to the community and ask them for drops. So those are essentially tarboards, like the ones you get on swift.org for Intel. Then there's one guy who's providing Debian packages for 64-bit Raspberry Pis. And I maintain a few Docker images on Docker Hub. So you can just search for RPI-Swift, and you'll find them. That's what I'm using all the time in the demos everywhere, because it's so convenient and stable. But that leads to the next question. So how do I get Docker on the Raspberry Pi? Right? So that's probably really hard. So you have to, I don't know, how do I even get a Linux on that, right? And then you have to install Docker and all that. And actually, that's really, really easy as well. So you take your SD card and you plug that into your Mac, which you can't, right? So you need an adapter. or you have an old Mac which still has proper ports. And then you download a tool called Flash from the Hip Riot project, which is great. And the Hip Riot OS is essentially just the Docker engine and a very small Linux OS. And using that Flash tool, you can just flash that operating system to your SD card. It takes about 1 minute, I would say, maybe 2 minutes, the whole thing, probably 5 minutes. Then you put that SD card into your Raspberry Pi, connect it to the power, and that's all you need to do. So it's going to boot up, you have the Docker engine running, and it's going to announce itself using Bonjour, so you can just ping the host name of the Raspberry Pi, and essentially immediately start running my Swift Docker containers. So that's that. It's really easy, so everyone can do that, trust me. But let's talk about the Swift ARM community. So I didn't do all that, right? So there's a community which is porting Swift to Raspberry Pi, and they are organized in the Swift-ARM Slack. So you can, you're free to join, everyone is welcome, can ask questions, be even more like contributors, of course. And if you just want to stay up to date on the project, I highly recommend the blog from Uraimo, who's putting out updates on the state of Swift on ARM. So then let's talk about the fact that the Swift.org website doesn't actually provide ARM binaries on its own, because it's really weird, right? Because all your devices, or ARM devices, are essentially the number one deployment platform for Swift, because the applications running on your iPhone, on the Apple TV, on your Apple Watch, but the old one is actually 32-bit too, those are all ARM devices. So most Swift code in the world is deployed on ARM devices. This is also why it's pretty easy to port that to the Raspberry Pi. There are a few reasons for on why they don't do that. I can't get into details about this, but the Apple in general is very open to getting patches for Raspberry Pi, so the compiler team, they are happy to accept PRs on that, and actually I did a port of Swift Neo to Raspberry Pi, and Johannes accepted the patch. It was really easy, by the way, and it even got accepted without providing tests. So, and another cool thing is that about 4 or 5 weeks ago, the Swift.org project announced that they are going to add external CI systems. So what that means is, if a Swift compiler developer is making a change to the compiler and submitting that to GitHub, the Swift ARM community CI is going to pick it up and try to build it. And if there's an issue with that, the Swift developer and, of course, the Swift ARM community immediately sees that there might be something they need to take care of. So things are really improving. In the past, something to be aware of, it was always the case that it took a while until you had like the latest Swift version on the Raspberry Pi. So right now we have 4.1.2. And today, just 4.2 got released, right? So it's probably going to take a few weeks until, maybe even month, until you're going to have that on the Raspberry Pi, because it needs to be ported and all that. Okay, so what is required if you're porting an application to Raspberry Pi? And usually nothing. So the only thing you need to, as you've seen in my demo, I didn't do anything special for running my Chaos endpoint on the Raspberry Pi. It's exactly the same thing like on my Mac. So there's one thing to be aware of, and that is that some Raspberry Pis are still running 32-bit kernels. So the latest ones, the 3, they actually have 64-bit CPUs, and they can run 64-bit Linux, but for legacy reasons, a lot of people are still running 32-bit on that. And that can lead to some issues in lower-level code, for example, like in Swift Neo. It's due to the sizes mostly of the int type, which is different on 32-bit and 64-bit. But your application would actually have exactly the same issues on the older watches, because they are also 32-bit devices. So that's nothing unusual, actually. So I guess with my patches, Swift Neo probably runs on the Apple Watch 3 now, too. So, okay, but let's try another demo. Hope this works. I have another Raspberry Pi over here. And this may look more like what you're imagining if you think about Raspberry Pis, cables and stuff. So this is a Raspberry Pi 3, with a 32-bit kernel, by the way, and it has a so-called shield attached. And what that does is it just converts those pins the Raspberry Pi has into nice sockets. So I'm not a person who is into hardware. I don't want to solder anything, but I still want to play with all that electronic stuff because it's fun, right? And you can buy those from Linkerkit, and you don't have to solder anything. You just use them. So that's the hardware part of that demo. Let's see whether it boots up. So just plug in the network and hope it powers up. Hardware demos. Let's see. Okay, but that's actually not really the reason I wanted to show you that. Let's see what software this Raspberry Pi is running. And that's actually a lot. So this Raspberry Pi has a Swift, an IRC server in Swift. So if someone doesn't know what IRC is, it's essentially Slack for old people like me. Slack is like the modern version of IRC. So I've wrote an IRC server in Swift using Swift Neo. And it also has a chatbot, which connects those Linkerkit components to IRC. So if a sensor detects something, it's going to report that in an IRC channel. And I can also send commands to the chatbot, and it's going to do something over here, hopefully. Then it also has a Swift Neo HTTP server and a WebSocket server integrated, and I'm going to show you what for. Let's see, so I need to start this application. So the other Pi is down. So, oops, no. I'm not going to show the source code of this stuff. It's all open source. You can find it on GitHub. So it looks like it's actually working. So as I said, it's running a kind of almost complete IRC server. So I can just take an arbitrary IRC client. So I'm going to use Textual. It's not an Electron app. It's a native app. And I already configured my Raspberry Pi, so you're going to see that Linkerkit channel, channel down here. And it's reporting what kind of accessories are attached to that. And let's see. So this is like a button component. It has like two buttons. Maybe I can press them. See? So the chatbot is detecting that the hardware is pressed, and it's essentially going to report that. So that's button two. That's button one. And I also have, that's a motion detector, but maybe the motion. Oh, yeah, so I have that in my office. So if I'm not moving, it's reporting that. So it's probably too much movement in here. So the temperature sensor, as you can see, it's actually not very reliable. I don't know. So minus foot. So that's this thing is essentially just talking to the IRC part over here. It's talking to the so my chat client is talking to the IRC server, and the chatbot is watching the channel for commands and stuff like that, and is executing them. So, but I also said that this contains a HTTP server, right? So let's go back to this and. Oh, I forgot to link in chaos, so it doesn't have that. Okay, so what the HTTP part does is it's essentially a very small web IRC client. So what happens here is that if I hit the HTTP server, it's going to deliver the HTML5 application. It's not using any frameworks. Nothing of that is using frameworks. It's just Swift Neo. And that the JavaScript contained in that HTML patch is connecting back to the WebSocket server, to the Neo WebSocket server, which is then acting as a bridge between IRC and WebSocket. So the WebSocket handler is going to open a connection to an IRC server, and then it sends commands to the IRC server and the other way around. Oh, you're also seeing ELISA, so that's another bot which is included in here. So it's a scalable psychotherapist, because it's running on Swift Neo, can do hundreds of thousands of patients. So I could actually start talking to myself using textual and my web front end, right? But let's try some more. So I also have like that 7-segment display. I don't know, it's probably hard to, I tried to bring it on the screen, but didn't work. But I can make this thing show stuff, like show 42. Who has that number? Okay, over there, 42, right? I don't know, trust me, it's showing 42. I can show Swift as well. So it's going to show Swift. And I can make it show a clock. So it's going to show a clock or a countdown. Show countdown or start countdown, doesn't matter, I think. Starting countdown, so it's counting down. And that functionality is essentially contained in that LinkerKit bot. So, but the point of my presentation here, or of the demo, whoops, wrong one, was that a Raspberry Pi is actually the current iteration. It's a really fast device. It's a quad-core server with a gigabyte of memory, and you cannot just use it to build like very simple applications, but instead you can run like complex servers like that. And if you would take that project a little further, I think you can almost build like an own small Slack, right? So a few things are missing, like persistence, like a few UI features, but you get native clients, which don't consume like 4 gigabytes of memory. Yeah, and you could probably run that on a Raspberry Pi. And now you might be thinking, yeah, but it's not going to run the 8 million active Slack users. But Slack is not actually running 8 million users in one instance, right? So it's more like a lot of companies running like 20 users in a Slack or 50 users. And I'm sure a Raspberry Pi 3 could easily host like 100 users in a service like that. So it's that fast. So what does the time say? Okay, I think we actually have time for that as well. So it's always hard to schedule like live demos because they never work, right? So if you're doing like server-side Swift software, you might be, I'm assuming you're already convinced that Swift is the only thing which makes sense, right? What else? Rust? No. So I think there are three reasons to use ARM platforms instead of Intel platforms, and those are like price, mobility, and power efficiency. So power efficiency, I think it's kind of obvious. So this one takes about 4 watts under full load, and my Mac Pro at home actually takes like 80 watts in idle. So what that means, and you can talk to me, I have a story about that, how my Mac Pro is consuming more energy than my washing machine and my dryer, and I have 2 daughters, so it's running all the time. So for the energy, Mac Pro in idle consumes, you can essentially run 20 Raspberry Pis, right? But now, who is going to use like 20 Raspberry Pis? That's stupid, right? Well, server developers do that because it's a great way to test out Kubernetes installations. So this thing is a 64-node Kubernetes cluster, and it's great for testing stuff and actually even running stuff because, as I said, those are pretty fast machines. That's power efficiency. I mean, mobility is kind of obvious, right? I mean, you see that in the small robot. So it's pretty tiny, so you can essentially take your server anywhere, for example, to like a Swift server conference or some crap like that. It also, because it takes a little energy, you can just power it from like a small solar panel or like a power bank. Yeah, it's essentially a disconnected device that way. And finally, the price of the hardware. And I think that's the most impressive thing about the Raspberry Pi, that massive amount of power you get for just 35 euros. There are also Intel devices, which are kind of competing with that, but they are usually around 100 euros, but more like 120, I think. So you can already buy like 3 or 4 Raspberry Pis for that price. And I think that can actually radically change how you deploy hardware as well, because instead of sending like a customer one point of sale device, you can send him 2. And if one breaks down, he just takes a new one. Right? You don't have to call IT or anything. But going back to the data center, I mean, the Kubernetes thing already was. So there are those machines. It's a 2-unit rack server, which packs 380 cores. Those are not Raspberry Pis, so they are like custom ARM boards, which have like 2.5 gigahertz. And that essentially means that you can get more than 2,000 cores in a single rack. Those are not the fastest processors, but it's a massive amount of cores which provide dedicated processing power to individual tasks. So I don't know what this what the price of that thing is, but I do know that it can't be too expensive, because there are cloud providers which sell you a slice of those for like €3 a month. And those are dedicated cores. Like, you get 4 dedicated cores, you get 2 gigabytes of memory, you get 50 gigabytes SSD for €3 a month. Yeah, it's not like some timeshare, it's a dedicated server, essentially. Okay, that's it. So you can contact me like that. I will point out my GitHub account, because I have a huge number of weird projects. Some are weird, some are fun, some are actually really useful. For example, I like the Postgres one, so I call it bringing Swift to the backend of the backend's backend. It allows you to write stored procedures in Swift. So PostgreSQL stored procedures. What else? Another thing I have is like that mod Swift thing, which allows you to write Apache modules in Swift, which is also really nice in my opinion. And many more. So I have like 8 organizations or something like that set up in GitHub, so look at those, contain lots of things. I also have that WebObjects clone in Swift, which everyone loves, right? Yeah, I guess I'm done.